When was the last time you saw yourself in a novel? I think for me and many others in my generation, Amy Tan's Joy Luck Club or Maxine Hong Kingston's Chinaman was probably the first time I saw an Asian American protagonist. But that was 30 years ago. Today, in 2022, thanks to a new generation of Asian authors, you are much more likely to see Asian characters in literature that are much more reflective of a genuine Asian American experience. Today, we have the extreme privilege of speaking with one of these new Asian American authors. Her first novel, Chemistry, put out in 2017, won many awards, and she was recognized as one of the five best young authors from that year. In January of 2022, her second novel, Joan is Okay, was released and is likewise gaining a lot of attention. Both of her novels center around Chinese American women who are like no other protagonists I've ever read. Both books are great, and we highly recommend them. On today's episode, we will talk about them with the person who knows them better than anyone else, because she wrote them. Today, we're chatting with author Weike Wang. How's it going? Welcome back to the podcast. Today, we're going to be talking about the amazing and endearing books written by Weike Wang. And today, we have a new co-host today coming along, someone on her first time with us, and she happens to be a writer herself. It's Emily. Hey, Emily. Welcome to the podcast.
Hi, Curtis. Hi, everybody.
So, you have a little bit in common with Weike. You started with science in college?
Yeah, I studied neuroscience in the beginning of undergrad and then ended up studying biology towards the middle of my undergrad and lit.
Yeah, and then you started doing literature in the middle?
Yeah. I wasn't doing so great in my bio classes and just wasn't feeling happy with it. So I kind of returned to my roots, returned to reading and my love for it, and started taking a lot of literature and writing classes.
And then you graduated and you make that hard left turn into an MFA program. What kind of went through your head on that? What were you thinking?
I honestly didn't know what I was going to do after I graduated. I thought I've known school for most of my life. Maybe I can continue that. And luckily, I got accepted into an MFA program back in San Francisco. So I just moved back up and started that.
Now, have you written anything? Can we read any of your stuff?
Yeah, I mostly write short stories and I've gotten a couple published, luckily. They're all on my website. It's my full name with a hyphen in the middle.com.
Okay, so we'll spell that out in our show notes. Can you relate it all to the protagonists in these books? What did you think? Did you see yourself at all in them?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I feel like I related a lot to how with both of them, they felt the sort of pressure to pursue an education and to pursue a career. And I definitely felt that growing up for my parents, because that's kind of all that they can give me, right? An education to do whatever, hopefully stable career, in the future.
Well, that was the easiest way, right? If you mm-hmm. kind of come from a family without a lot of means, education, I still believe this, right? Education mm-hmm. is still the easiest way, not the easiest, but is definitely you can connect the dots, I think, between education and stable life,
Yeah, definitely. That was kind of all they knew, and that they didn't have that growing up, so they wanted to supply that for me and my brother.
Was it a little tricky to convince them that writing or English could be a thing that you can make a living doing?
Oh, definitely. Yeah, before trying to go into the healthcare career, I was like, yeah, maybe I'll be a teacher. And they understood that. They could see a clear trajectory, towards right. that career. And then when I mentioned maybe I'll do teaching later and I'm going to be a writer now, they were like, okay, that's cool. We don't know what you're doing, what you're writing, how to get there. But now they're kind of more on board with supporting me.
Yeah. Well, we'll definitely talk to Weike about that. We'll definitely pick her brain about what it's like to transition from science to writing. So thank you so much for coming along today.
Yeah. Thank you for having me.
Yeah. All right. And so our special guest today is still kind of at the beginning of her writing career, but she's already established herself as one of America's best young authors. We have with us today award-winning author, Weike Wang. Hey, Weike.
Hey, nice to be on the show. Thanks for being so enthusiastic.
Oh man, thanks so much for joining us. We are, I mean, this is quite a week for you. You were on the Today Show earlier this week.
I was.
Yeah. And now you're on our show. But you are busy. Yeah, thank you for giving us some of your time.
No, it's fine. It's actually, you know, it's sort of just like trying to manage, you know, when you're on kind of things like the Today Show or when you're doing events, you're sort of just, as you know, just making time for it. And then you kind of have to maneuver, you know, your real life around these other events. So sometimes that can get a little hectic, but it's fun. It's fun. I'm glad to do it. And I'm glad to kind of like recommend books to people.
Yeah. Is this part of the job that you can't, like, did you know anything about this when you went into writing? Did you say, oh, you know, someday I might be on the Today Show or, you know, doing interviews?
No. I mean, I think what drew me to writing is I really like the writing aspect of it. Sure. And what actually surprised me is what being a writer sort of means in the modern day era. I think there's a sense of, you know, you sort of need a brand, you sort of need kind of some sort of like social media clout, which is like, can you imagine Ernest Hemingway getting on social media ever? You know, like, would he ever do that? No, but there's just certain things where I think when you're still beginning and starting to find an audience, unless you're super famous, you still need to get your word out there and sort of tell people what to read and just kind of crawl a readership. And I think that was the part that sort of surprised me, but it's enjoyable. I mean, it's nice to meet people and it's nice to have engagement. And I'm just happy that, you know, I'm getting asked to do these things.
Oh, yeah, no, it's cool to see you doing them. Yeah. And are you in New York City or where are you at these days?
I'm in New York City. I'm by Columbia University. So I'm like in the upper West Side area.
Yeah. You know, my memory of that area is Cuban Chinese food. Do you ever go to La Caribe or any of those places?
There's a lot of Cuban and like Dominican food here.
Yeah.
A lot of fusion cuisines.
Yeah. Great. Okay, so how about a little bit more about you, Weike? Your parents are from Nanjing, and you were born there?
Yeah, I was.
Fun fact, I was actually, so I'm much older than you, so I was in Nanjing in the early 90s.
Oh, cool.
So there's a chance I could have bumped into your parents, or maybe even a baby Weike?
Sure, no, 100%. What were you there for?
I was a senior in college, and I had a professor doing research on Lake Tahoe in California here. It's one of our big lakes. And he had a partner that was doing research on Taihu in Wuxi. Oh. And so I was super excited when I was reading this book. There's a reference to Taihu in this book. So,
yeah.
So I was sent to China for a month. I was there for a month and I was living at Nanjing Normal University, if you know what
that is. Oh, wow. Cool.
But yeah, I was living in the foreign student building and helping this professor. He could write in English, and I would translate his English into better English.
yeah, I mean, Nanjing is actually, it's like a cool city. I wish, I don't know when I'm going to be able to go back, but.
Yeah, right.
You know, kind of a big bummer.
We did a travel episode, and I recommended it. You know, everyone knows Shanghai, and everyone knows Beijing.
The way I sell it, it's a big city, but it's sort of like the Gettysburg of China. Like it has a lot of like civil history, you know, if you think about Civil War, right? You think of like Gettysburg, Virginia, or you think of Richmond. That's kind of that city for me. Like the nationalist government was there and they had a lot of kind of issues. It used to be a former capital. Uh-huh. You know, so it's kind of like very similar to sort of like the revolutionary stuff that you have to learn in American social stuff.
Yeah. But it's got a wall. It's got its own little wall. It's got Sun Yat-sen Mausoleum. It's a cool place. So you moved to the U.S. Where did you land when you moved to the U.S.?
So when I first came here, I was in Worcester, Massachusetts. And that's kind of this like small town, Western Massachusetts. And then we moved to a couple of different places in Michigan. And then I came back to the East Coast for college.
And what were you like as a kid? Were you more kind of sciencey, or were you the bookworm in the corner, or were you a mixture of both? Or?
You know, I mean, I think, I don't know if a lot of kind of Asian kids of my generation can relate to this. I didn't come from a huge reading family. I think it's because of there's just a language difference. There's a cultural difference. And, you know, whatever my parents were reading in Chinese, they probably wouldn't be able to recommend to me. So there is sort of this loss of capital in that way. So I didn't necessarily come from a reading family. So I wasn't a big reader. I read what I had to in school, and I read like silly things like, you know, the Babysitter's Clubs and like Goosebumps and things like that. But I wasn't reading, you know, when I did my MFA, people were like, oh my God, I read, you know, my dad introduced me to Cheever. That was not my dad. My dad did not introduce me to Cheever. So I was just reading kind of like silly stuff. And then I was much more of a science and math person, because I think my father is very good at science and math. And he just kind of taught me a lot of these things. And, you know, it's a little bit easier to, it's like, it crosses a lot of languages, right? Like you can translate it, but yeah. I mean, mitosis and meiosis are not changing in Europe versus China.
Emily, can you relate to that at all? Were you a reader at all as a kid?
Yeah. I mean, I read like Harry Potter and just like a bunch of and like also a bunch of like funny things too. And it's funny because when I started taking lit classes, all these classics like Little Women or Pride and Prejudice, like I had no idea until I took those classes.
Yeah. And I think one of the things was like what kind of pushed me away from literature at the beginning. And I think this is what pushes a lot of, you know, to be honest, like other people out of science is like there's almost this intimidation factor, right? Like if you don't know this, oh, how could you not know this? Whereas like at this point, if, you know, I have a student who doesn't know how to multiply fractions, and I'm like, you're 25 years old. You know how to do this. Right? Like, I can intimidate in a way that, you know, like I was intimidated for writing. And I can see why sometimes science and math gets intimidating, because you're like, oh my God, these, you know, Asian kids are just going to like blow me out of the water. And I was one of them, I'm sure. But I could see it working both ways.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So your parents play a pretty big role in, not your parents, but the parents of the characters in your books play a pretty prominent role. Well, what were your parents like growing up? Were they supportive of you doing whatever you want, or did they kind of steer you one way or the other?
You know, I think I'm going to have to sidestep that question. My parents are very supportive of, to a certain extent, of me being independent. And I think they did a very good job of raising me to be very independent. I think my mother's worst fear was that I was going to be a starving artist who would like, I don't know, like use her credit card to fly to, you know, Budapest or something and photograph something that I didn't need to photograph. So I think my parents are really afraid of that. And they raised me to be very independent. I think after I went to college, I was financially independent because it was very subsidized for my family. And after that, I got a job, I tutor, I still work for a tutoring company. And I sort of just made it, promise myself that if I'm going to go into art, I'm never going to ask my parents for money or for that kind of like financial support. And I haven't. And I think I wouldn't say they're like thrilled that I'm a writer. I'm sure they would have much rather I've been a biology teacher, to be honest. But I think they're kind of realizing some of the aspects that are good about being in the arts. It's hard to sort of teach someone of that, or, you know, not teach, but make them aware that representation is important, because I don't think they've ever thought about that question, nor was that a question important to their survival. Like, you know, we're talking about a generation who lived through Cultural Revolution, Tiananmen Square, that kind of stuff. And I don't think that was really an important question to them. But I think they're being very respectful of how I spend my time. And they're not very nosy about it anymore. And I actually think that's kind of a win. You know, you got to take what you can get.
So you do end up going, so out of high school, you end up going to Harvard and you pick chemistry. What was the thinking behind that?
You know, I wanted to say that when I was, for most of my 20s, before I totally went into writing, I was sort of like the golden child. Like I went to Harvard, I had a chemistry major, I did public health, sort of some sort of health oriented thing. I chose chemistry because Harvard has a notoriously difficult chemistry department. And I think I was kind of like a sadist. Like I thought I was going to do the hardest top, like, you know, I was always taught to challenge myself to like kind of push myself further. And then you go to, go to Harvard and you meet all these people who do like history of science. And like, you just meet all these like people who you're just like, why? And later on you meet alumni and I'm just like, I don't even know what that major is. That's fine. So I was just a statist and I thought, oh my God, the chemistry department at Harvard is so intense. They've had so many kind of like unhappy stories, a lot of crazy, like, you know, scientists. I really want to prove myself and work for them. But I think my GPA would have been a lot higher if I had done something else. It was one of these things. And I'm glad I did it. I think it was, I learned a lot. I actually have not forgotten most of the chemistry I've learned from Harvard. I've retained a lot of that, especially the biochemistry. And it taught me to be a very good thinker. And it taught me sort of what grad school is going to be like, because they kind of don't, you know, they don't mess around. There's no training wheels. There's just like, you just do it. Because you meet so many smart people at Harvard. Like, I thought I was smart. And then I got to Harvard. Right. And then I was just like my ego is thoroughly bruised from being at Harvard, because you meet some really smart people. But one of the wonderful things about Harvard was that it is inherently a liberal arts school. I'm not doing a commercial for Harvard. They don't need my help. But it is inherently a liberal arts school. And I wouldn't have gotten into writing had I not met teachers there who really encouraged writing for me. Yeah. And I don't think a lot of other schools are like that. I'm sure every year Harvard accepts, you know, Asian students who are very smart at math, very smart at science. But I think they're also looking for students who are like curious. And yeah. I was just a little bit curious to kind of like jump over to the other side and take a lot of English classes and take a lot of art history classes and just sort of explore their curriculum, though it did not help my GPA.
And you got to use a little of the chemistry in your books.
Yeah.
It's all paid off. And then, so after graduate, were you thinking medical school and then you pivoted to public health, or what happened there?
Yeah, I spent 2 years working as a clinical researcher with a cardiologist team. And I think that really disabused me of what medicine was. I was working at Longwood, which is where Harvard's public health school was at. I had a friend who's in public health and it sounded really interesting. For me, it almost felt like a compromise between something that was a little bit more humanities based and science and sort of biostatistics based. So I thought it was going to be a good kind of middle ground for me. And, you know, whenever you compromise, I think sometimes it's hard to kind of see both sides. But yeah. I actually had an excellent grad school advisor. Chemistry is not based on this advisor at all. I actually had one of the nicest, lab PIs as a grad student I could have ever asked for. And I think that's when I really knew that maybe epi or public health wasn't my passion. And I don't want to just, you know, use passion in the word like frivolously, but I had like a pretty great experience. I had, you know, 4 papers come out in grad school. They were pretty straightforward papers. My PI was really nice. No one was unhappy in his lab. And I didn't love it. And so I just thought if I couldn't love it in that situation, you know, I might as well just like tether myself to this wagon for writing and see what happens with that.
So were you concurrently enrolled in the MFA while you were doing your PhD?
Yeah, I was. Because, you know, back to the parents, my mother wasn't super sold on this idea of, you know, like, think about it. You tell your parents, I'm going to leave Harvard to do writing. I think they're just a little shocked. And I think even white parents would be a little shocked. They just want to just be confused, right?
Yeah.
And in their confusion, I think they're like, I think you need to finish this degree so that you have some sort of backup if the writing thing doesn't work. And I see that now. You know, I do see that parents they're just nervous that you're not making the best choice.
Sure. When did you start writing chemistry? Was that part of the MFA or is that a little bit after?
That was part of my MFA thesis. Yeah.
So I see the pieces falling together here a little bit. Yeah. And so you write chemistry, it comes out in 2017. Was it overnight success or did it take a little bit for people to find it?
I think it takes a little bit. Just like with Joan is okay, I think it's always taking a little bit. And I think this always just speaks a little bit more to what it's like to be an Asian writer in an American publishing industry. Mm-hmm. So I'm glad, you know, it got the recognition that it did. We weren't expecting that. And I think my publishing house wasn't expecting that. So I'm just very flattered and pleased that it has gotten attention, but I don't think initially it was, thought to do well.
Yeah. But you win the Penn Hemingway Award. It's for new authors for their debut novel, and you're named to the National Book Foundation's 5 Under 35 to keep an eye on. And it wins other awards as well. And you start making a little bit of the tour circuit, and you're doing more speaking. Was that just a whirlwind for you coming out of grad school, and all of a sudden, you know, people are asking to come on TV and whatnot?
Sort of. I think that was my first rodeo with publishing. And okay, so I, you know, if you come from like any kind of science background, it's the publishing and television world is so different, because I think it's just run by people who are right-minded, you know, like you're sort of like governed by their right brain. But it was nice to dip into the water. I mean, I think, you know, I like it enough to still do it. I was in science for like 2 decades, and at the end I was like, I couldn't do it. But it's really helped me. I used to be pretty introverted. It was actually hard for me to talk fluidly about my work. And I actually think doing a lot of events has helped me be a little bit better public speaker in expressing what I like to do in my work, what I want to accomplish, what I want to represent. And that's also important. It sort of helps the speaking and the writing together.
Yeah, for sure. And so earlier this year, your second novel comes out, and it was released January 2022. It's called Joan is Okay. It was on many people's most anticipated books list, and it's New York Times Editor's Choice, and we just read it. So congratulations on that.
Thank you. Thank you guys for reading.
It was definitely our pleasure. Emily, what are your first thoughts on this book after reading it?
It was a really great read. I mean, I read Joan is Okay first and then went to chemistry. And both were just such a fun read. Like, I love how you've like put humor into it. It was like such a fast read for me for both.
Oh, good. Good. I always hope to make it a fast read, even though it takes me years of my blood, sweat, and tears.
I was the opposite. I looked at them. I was like, 200 pages. I can finish this in a week, you know, and then, but it's deliberate. Your writing is so deliberate, you know, you're in the head of these people, right? And I had to think a lot, you know, maybe it's just me, but I had to think about why is she saying that, or why, you know, there's a lot of questioning going on. So I appreciated that part of it as well. So I guess for some it's quick, and maybe have you heard that from most people it's quick, or do people take their time?
Yeah, I think, you know, chemistry, because it was kind of about a woman who was suffering sort of like from a mental, just like a break in terms of career things. And it was very reflective of just how I thought about things in my 20s. Joan is much more of an older, more sort of sure of herself person. And I knew Joan was going to be a risk, because the narrative of chemistry, that's a coming of age story. The first book to write, the easiest to write, is a coming of age story. And I think most debut writers write that. And I was no different. I just kind of wanted to stylize it and do something different with it. Joan was kind of a different beast in that I knew she wasn't going to kind of bend to other people. And I knew she was going to be either kind of, for some readers, and I'm just thinking about the American readership, they're either going to sort of hate this character or really love this character, since she is, I would say, very representative of an Asian doctor that represents a third of the health force in this country. And this character, though, because of probably their quirks, is not written about, or because it somehow fords or something about the model minority, whatever, it's like not talked about. Yeah. And I think it's important. I think it's important to highlight this kind of character who has sort of become singly molded by work and her desire to kind of push herself through work, and sort of striving, and sort of her parents' immigrant story. I kind of wanted that flattened character at the beginning, because I see that all the time. I'm like friends with these people.
Yeah, we know them too.
Yeah, and I think oftentimes we're not talked about because there's a sense that we want to see crazy rich Asians on TV. Right. We want to kind of have this Asian person that's enviable and handsome and rich and vapid, you know? They're just like white people because like, look at them, right? And I think that is somewhat dangerous because it sort of erases a lot of what got, you know, a lot of my generation into the workforce. And they're hardworking people, but I think they really had to trim a lot of them, like their own personality down to kind of fit a certain mold that a company wanted or, you know, like what they were looking for, things like that.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
So
do you get a lot of fans and readers who say, thank you for writing about me, you know, because
I do, it's a mix. I get a mix of both. I get, you know, Instagram is kind of a blessing and a curse. Right. I get a lot of tags like, I really love this book. Thank you for writing it. And then I get a lot of tags being like, I have no idea why you wrote her. She's so confusing. Uh-huh. You know, I don't really get her, or like chemistry. Like, is she depressed or does Joan have autism? And what kind of makes me realize, and I knew that's why like these books are risky to write sometimes, is that the medical field is defined by like, you know, medicalization is defined by the other, right? Like if you have a bunch of American doctors figuring out, oh, well, this person's robotic and blah, 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 and she's Asian and she's autistic, you know, there's a sense of kind of like binning categories. And I do see that sometimes. Yeah, like, yeah. I don't really get your character because she kind of just seems autistic because it sort of fits like this stereotype that I have in my head of like Asian people being very quiet and just working a lot. And maybe not noticing that I'm trying to satirize this or caricaturize this or kind of like lean into it. How, you know, it would be, how would I not be aware of these stereotypes I grew up with, right? So there's sometimes that sort of force. And I think that's what makes writing about, you know, characters like this and American publishing a little bit difficult. It's just trying to find the audience, connecting with the audience, and but not, you know, having to justify everything or explain everything, right?
Let me read the description of Joan is Okay, and then I think we're going to throw out a spoiler alert, so I'll read this first and then maybe we'll get into the juicy details. Sorry. So this is from Penguin Publishing. Joan is a 30-something ICU doctor at a busy New York City hospital, the daughter of Chinese parents who came to the United States to secure the American dream for their children. Joan is intensely devoted to her work, happily solitary and successful. She does look up sometimes and wonder where her true roots lie, at the hospital, where her white coat makes her feel needed, or with her family, who try to shape her life by their own cultural and social expectations. All right. And we should also say it takes place in about 6 months from 2019 until early 2020. Yeah. That's important detail, right?
Well, that is an important detail.
So, all right, everyone out there, if you have not read the book, go ahead and get a copy and read it and come back and listen to the second half of this podcast. Usually we play a little music to kind of let people get away from their devices before we spoil it. Any ideas what song we should play? I was thinking maybe some Beatles in honor of Eric.
Beatles is a good idea. I saw your note on the doc and I was like, yeah, I think that's a good song. Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. So here are the Beatles when the song's over. You better be gone or you'll hear some spoilers. Let's talk about this book. Let's talk about some characters. Let's talk about Joan. First of all, Joan has a name. That's kind of new. That's kind of a new thing.
Yeah, I'm trying something new, naming my characters.
But that becomes pretty important. I think later on we learn that her name was in the book, was Joan first or Juan first? What came first?
I think both, because I needed to find a name that was translatable in both. I just couldn't do it if it couldn't kind of go back and forth, right? And that's, you know, to your question of why I don't do names, it's so hard. Like, I get stuck on this cycle. It's a loop that, you know, I think a lot of not me would get into. There's just so many, this is my Chinese name, this is my American name, in the sense of, well, I chose a Chinese name to make it easier for you to pronounce. And so like all of that, you know, yeah. is in my head. Right. And names have so much to do with identity, but So I was kind of grappling with that for most of stories. And I think I don't name characters unless I can come up with a good name for them. Like I know this name is going to stick. This is a good name. I can kind of break it apart. And if it's going to be a Chinese name, I do want to write in the Chinese. I think it's nice to be able to see Chinese on text in an approachable way. I don't think people do that, but people put French and Spanish and Italian in books all the time, and I have no idea what they're writing. So I think it's important for Chinese characters to get some sort of space and kind of like an English, you know, text.
Yeah, I thought that was beautiful. And I heard that at one point you were maybe a Vicky.
Oh, I was thinking of changing my name to Vicky before college, just because, you know, you could kind of like say this is your name, Weike, and then you could kind of change it. And I was just I couldn't do it. Like, I didn't want to change my name. And it's already an Americanized pronunciation, and I'm fine with it. You know, I'm fine with it being pronounced the Chinese way when I'm with my family and people who are Chinese. And it being just Americanized in another. It's pretty easy. I usually say Weike, it rhymes with Nike, or it's like Beach. It's like very, I've never had an issue with it. I've just had people misspell it, but like I've never had people like mispronounce it after I've kind of like told them how it's pronounced.
But that's part of the Chinese American or Asian American experience for a lot of kids, you know. Like I teach in San Francisco, and Emily knows that our school is heavily Asian. Mm-hmm. And that's the dilemma for a lot of kids, you know, and they come in and they change their name to make it easier for teachers maybe suggest it, you know, like, and that happens all the time. And, you know, if you're an 8-year-old kid, you're going to go with what your teacher says, of course. Right. And sometimes it's just, it can be a little heartbreaking at times. So I'm glad you put that in there, that she has both names. And then she even has her parents call her a Chinese version of Joan. They call her Jonah, right? Like they change it a little to make it easier for them. So
I think the whole point was no one in this book actually calls her really by Joan.
Oh, that's true.
Like they all have their version of her. Like, you know, Tammy's like, oh, Joanie, because she's like a little sister. And Fong calls her Joanne. And, you know, her mom is like Jonah. like no one really calls her by her name. And I think that's kind of just like an echo of occasionally just, you know, if you stick with a Chinese name or something, or a foreign name or anything that's like kind of, you have families in many different continents, right? Many different generations. Yeah. There's just this schizophrenic fracturing of your name, and you just sort of end up living with it. Like I was talking to a friend, and she was like, you know, I get really angry when people call me Anna instead of Anna. And I think I just stared at her. I was like, okay. And obviously, you know, she's like, you know, white American girl who I think that was like her biggest split with her name. And I just, you know, you have to be understanding. But after a while, you're like, I don't, you know, it's different. It's very different. And I think it's important that, I don't know, we kind of keep Chinese names. I'm sort of a big proponent of that, or find some sort of compromise, or, you know.
Yeah, no, I agree. Emily, you have a Chinese name, or do you go, is it translated at all?
Yeah, I do have a Chinese name. I don't really get called that anymore. Like my parents will sometimes call it, like they used to call it when they were mad at me. And then I like revealed it one time to like my friends in high school and in college. And it like kind of got made fun of because it's Wang Siman, and it like sounds like a certain word.
In Cantonese.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
it's a common story where it's like, you know, I was talking to the author Phuc Tran, and P-H-U-C, and you know, it's easy for his name to be turned into other words, so it's tough, you know, but it's part of the experience, so I'm really glad that you put that in there.
Yeah.
And then you can't help but notice that your main characters tend to have science backgrounds. That's not by accident, I take it.
No, I mean, I think it's easy for me to kind of get away with it because I don't need to do that much research. I mean, I did actually have to do a lot of research for Joan, but it's not as, if I had chosen to, I guess, like do a photographer or do a film director, I would have like been so out of like my depth. But I think these kinds of things I'm better at. Oftentimes science occupations and fiction get, it's just totally wrong, right? Like you either have this God complex or you have just like bad renderings of this kind of job when it's sort of just like every other job and the people are just as crazy as every other occupation. And they're smart, but they just know their own like little 2x2 square of information.
Yeah.
And to be honest, you know, some of my doctor friends who read Joan were like, I wish you had made her more glamorous. I was like, you're like too glamorous. You complain to me every day about finding poop on your shoes. I don't know why you wanted something glamorous. You can watch Grey's Anatomy. That's glamorous.
About Joan, she's kind of a workaholic. Like, why? Can you kind of talk a little bit more about like why she likes to work so much?
Yeah. So I wrote, you know, the essay Notes on Work, as along with when Joan came out. And to be honest, I mean, I know so much about being a workaholic because I am a workaholic, but why am I fascinated by this? Well, I think there's something workaholic about just American culture in general, something that kind of accelerated through the pandemic across all races. I think Americans like to work, you know, they at least like two generations ago. I don't really know about Gen Z right now. The jury is really still out on Gen Z. But like think about like post-war America, right? The industrial kind of like that sort of working industry person. And I think that's really ingrained in our culture in some ways. And I wanted to pivot that with this rising animal of wellness, which is now everywhere, right? The sense of like mental health and wellness and sort of, you know, if you have one migraine, don't come to class, like something like that, where it's like, there's just, you know, humans can't modulate. So it's this like crazy pendulum. And I wanted to sort of echo that with the kind of like the immigrant background in a way that isn't like toiling and totally suffering, but like working in a very respected field, but just like she's working so much because I don't think she knows what else to do. Like she's just been trained to do this and she does it incredibly well. And her boss seems fine with it and kind of just like moves forward with it. And it's again meant to be an exaggeration because if I wrote real life, it wouldn't be fiction. It would have been fun to read. It wouldn't have momentum, right?
Yeah.
It wouldn't be surprising. But I did wanted to kind of just comment of the sense of, you know, I was in a maid of honor like crew with six other doctors. And pretty much when they're talking, they just want to kind of like outcompete each other about who works the most. And I don't know why anyone wants to win that game. It's like the worst game to win. But there's a sense that you're kind of not worth anything in this country if you don't work. And that's the immigrant mentality, right? Like if you don't have anything to provide, why would they want you here? Right? And I think that's a very harsh but cruel truth to oftentimes this kind of like, I would say this sort of like stipulation of studying a lot, working a lot, you know, you have to have some sort of like value, right? And your value is measured in work and skill.
Yeah. Yeah. Let's talk about the guys. I like the guys. It sounds like you like the guys, is it right?
I do like supporting the guys.
So we have her colleague, Reese. He's kind of the pamphlet cover model. Reese, he's a doctor. Her neighbor, Mark, who is he's a consultant. He's a literary consultant or what's his
job? He's sort of like, you know, it's one of these jobs that I did not know existed. And you guys probably don't know either. Like this freelance editor, you know, like they make like $100 an hour just editing somebody's manuscript. It's kind of insane to me.
And her older brother, Fong.
Yeah.
So, I mean, they all have their flaws, but I think overall, they all have good intentions, right? They all love Joan in their own way, right?
Yes, yes. And, you know, they're all sort of like versions of, you know, they're like kind of like entertaining, but oftentimes one note characters that are good to kind of put into a comedy like this. And they all sort of represent multiple facets of their life. Like Reese is really, he doesn't want to admit it, but he's sort of just threatened by Joan at work, even
though
one of the things with work is Joan is not preventing Reese from working hard. You know, Joan is just like doing her own thing. And I think the threat of Reese is like, well, if you're working hard, then I can't. But no one's hindering Reese. Like, that's the that's like the mental block he doesn't have. And Mark is sort of this, like, you know, neighborly New Yorker who's always telling you what to read, what to eat, what to watch, like this, like, culture beacon, bastion. And they're all well-intentioned, and they're all kind of, like, trying to just sort of mold Joan into something that they would want to, you know, they could kind of claim, right? I think oftentimes when people are like, you should read this. And then when I read it, they're like, oh, I taught her. I told her how to read. I told her what that's what she needed to read. Sense of claiming that you were the source of that kind of information or that kind of change is what these people are, you know, seeking. And all of them sort of have this, like, older brother sort of vibe to them. That they see that she's maybe suffering or, you know, suffering in her own way, and they just want to help.
I definitely said, like, because she's small too, right? We know right away she's about 5 foot tall, and maybe because she's unconventional and quiet, it just makes guys around her feel like they need to save her, you know, need to so the guys are there, and we like them, but then in the end we realize that she doesn't need any help. she's fine. And then probably the most complicated relationship is her mom. I think the most complicated relationship was her mom and she. What can you say about their relationship? They don't say a lot of words to each other, but they communicate constantly, and they're always...
Right. I think they communicate sort of through just, like, being together, you know, spending time together and not filling that time with fluff. Not the American sitcom family where you kind of just, like, laugh and, you know, jerk and go fishing or something. They're just spending time together, and that's what they think is care. But they're also very hard on each other, you know, and they're hard on each other. And only this kind of, like, family who's sort of been through a lot can be right. Yeah. And I think company goes a long way. Attention goes a long way. But one of the biggest complaints of a family like this, if you're living in it, is just it feels like you're getting suffocated, and it just feels like everyone is trying. But that kind of attention is also care, you know, whether it is kind of not the care that is like, oh, I'm going to, you know, give you a cookie kind of care, but it is care. And it's the care that I think if you didn't feel suffocated, then you would feel totally alone, right?
Yeah. Do you get comments that this resonates a little more with Asian American audience, the relationship?
Yeah, I think so. I think I get a sense of, people who get the relationship, you know, a lot of, I think, readers also would have a hard time with that relationship. I wanted to write a relationship with parents, like Asian parents sometimes in fiction and in nonfiction get so shafted by the writer because we're just kind of blinded by rage in some ways. And I think there's a sense of, like, fairness that has to be delivered to these characters because they don't have a voice. They're never going to write in English. That is sort of the lost generation. And so if I am kind of putting that character there, I sort of need to give it some sort of fairness, but some sort of truth. I have no interest in making her the white, like, mean girl's mom. You know, I have no interest in making her that mom. I have no interest, though, in kind of, like, playing down some of the honest things that just have to be talked about in this family, you know? And so that's just a hard balance to strike. Like, she's not the mom who says honey and sweetheart and pumpkin and is just, like, your cheerleader, you know, because that just feels like total assimilation to me and untruthful. But I also didn't want her to make her, you know, these like mothers who just come off as complete villains in books that have there's no tenderness to that character.
Right. I think not necessarily for myself, but I know there are people who could relate to the sitting in the taxi for 20 minutes just to process everything in silence.
It's hard. I mean, I think, you know, my parents, if I think about it, they were my only family for, like, 13 years, right? Like, if I left China when I was, like, 6, and they're your only friends because if you're moving a lot, they're really your only friends. So, and I didn't have any siblings. So I think about how that they're just my world. Right. And how can you kind of separate that for a character like this?
All right. Emily, you want to talk about structure a little bit?
So I guess with both books, like there's, you don't really separate it out with like chapters, but there's like this fragmentation in the narrative and that like reads almost like a stream of consciousness. So I was wondering if like that kind of came naturally as you were writing it. Was it intentional to fragment it that way? And like just overall, like how did you really like structure both books and like if there was a difference, I guess?
I'm not against chapters. I just think sometimes it kind of moves with like the cliffhanger and then you go to the next chapter. I like the sense of structure that helps with momentum. So I think individual sections always work for me. I do like more of a collage style because a collage style is always easier to write. And then shuffling things like present and past action in there. So sometimes it doesn't feel my writing naturally lends itself to chapters because I don't find a, you know, stopping point and then I'm like new chapter. Right. Mm-hmm. And the thing I'm working on now, I mean, it's third person, but it also doesn't have chapters. I think I just sort of like the individual segments. I sort of like to kind of create a perfect segment.
And then let's talk about the timing of this book a little bit. Did you write this book before the pandemic or right in the middle of the pandemic? How did the timing of this book?
I had turned in, it's so unfortunate. I turned in a copy of a draft of it March 2020 and it had no pandemic. Wow. And so I had to rewrite. I had to rewrite a lot of it to kind of incorporate the pandemic aspect.
And it becomes kind of another character, right? It's a huge part of the plot, right? Where
yeah, it is a huge part of the plot.
As soon as you start mentioning fall 2019, and you know, I think it's so fresh in our mind, right? Like
it seems so fresh. It was just no way around it. I'd already picked her occupation. She was an ICU doctor before.
In New York
COVID
City.
started, like before COVID started, you know? And then I thought, you know, December, I was like, is this going to be a big deal? No, I don't think it's going to be a big deal.
We all did, yeah.
And then it was like, oh my God, I have to figure out a way to like include all of this, right? So that was kind of a bummer to really.
And then did that affect how you brought... The second half of the book has a lot more culture in it. You know, you bring in the Chinese characters. And did that come about because of the pandemic as well? And the
a little bit
narrative.
She has nothing to do. So she in the second half of the book. She can go to work. I sometimes think work is a distraction. The occupation, you know, and I think a lot about this. Like, I think why did my parents really want me to be a doctor? Because that's like a master identity. Like, it doesn't matter if you're Chinese, it doesn't matter if you're a woman, you're a doctor, you know? And I think how great, but also how somewhat unfortunate that is to not want to be these people, you know, to kind of be somewhat embarrassed to be these people, right? And that goes back to the name thing, to be embarrassed to be Asian. And I say that that's true because I've experienced it, right? Wow. The sense of, you know, you just want to be everyone else. But there's something very dangerous about that too. Right? Mm-hmm. And if you have a generation just wanting to not be that, then it's problematic. So I think there's something to be said about like Chinese culture, Asian culture, but especially Chinese culture in this book, because the virus comes from China and it just kind of accelerated so many, I don't think stereotypes that were gone, but stereotypes that people just didn't think was okay to say, but then could again, right? And that was very disappointing. And I think oftentimes, you know, I bring in Chinese characters because I kind of want to encourage the next generation to read and write Chinese. It really is scary how quickly Chinese is forgotten. Like that doesn't happen in Spanish. That doesn't happen with French. That doesn't happen with any Western white speaking language. Russian doesn't happen with that. Doesn't even happen with Korean. Think about that, you know?
Yeah.
But like the next generation, no one wants to speak Chinese. And I attribute that to oftentimes the anti-Asian, anti-China sentiment that's always in the US.
Sure.
It's very exhausting. And I think some of that kind of comes out in my writing to kind of express the frustration of that sort of identity growing up here.
I think maybe we'll end on this one. One big idea in this book, I think, is home.
And
what were you thinking when you're thinking of the idea of home for this book?
Right. I mean, home for her, I do believe, is in the workplace. She loves that place and she doesn't put any stock in her actual home base. But I think by the end of the book, she's thinking more about, well, you know, her home can expand, right? And also Her home is sort of where she feels safe. And maybe that's at work. Maybe that's with her brother, right? But I think there are certain points where she needs to feel safe. So at the end, when she's like kind of self-isolating in her own house, that's really where she feels unbothered, safe, and that she's, you know, not quote unquote taking up too much space, right? It kind of comes back to that first line of she's always a little worried of how much space she's taking up, right? In terms of what she can provide. And I think at the end, she gets to a slightly more mature idea of home. But if you ask me, I don't know where my home is. You know, I was born in place. I live in New York. And I think New York is at this point my home because it's where I've developed my professional life, right? But it, I don't have relatives in the state other than, you know, my parents who live in Michigan. So like, where is home, right? Like, I don't have a hometown. I don't have family that lives within like two zip codes of each other, right? And I think that question is unanswerable at a certain level. I think my kids would have a home. I think my, it takes three generations really to kind of create this. My grandmother has a home, you know, my cousin in China has a home because she,
they've never left
there for like, like hundreds of years. So,
And then we have a question that we do at the end of these segments. It's called "Who's Your Infatuasian?" An infatuasian is anyone that you admire in the Asian community. Could be alive or deceased, or someone you know, or someone you don't know. So, Weike Wang, who is your infatuasian at this moment?
Oh my God, that's actually really hard. I'm gonna have to. What are some of the answers that you?
We've gotten Bruce Lee. We've gotten, you know, my grandfather. We've gotten, let's see. Yeah, it's just someone that's on the tip of your mind that, you know, you could name something in the news or anything.
Oh, this is so hard. I mean, I think, you know, if it's not a famous person, it would have to be my grandfather, because my grandfather is really the only person in my family who made an effort to read my first stories in English. Like, he would translate every word from English to Chinese. And he introduced me to Mariah Carey. He was a huge Mariah Carey and Celine Dion fan, even though he had no idea what they were saying. And Red Hot Chili Peppers. Like, he introduced me to these musicians in a way that my parents never would have. I don't think my parents know who Red Hot Chili Peppers are. And you know, my grandfather is really into that. And then he played me like Hotel California. And I was like, how do you even know what they're saying? I don't think so. But he sort of liked the music, and he was a physicist. So, and you know, he lived and died in China. So I think there is a sense of Asian being very interested in culture. You just need to take the survival question of immigration out for them to have time to think about culture.
No, sounds like a cool guy.
Yeah, he was very cool.
All right. And then the last question is, do you have any recommendations for us, Asian author that we should be reading? Maybe get on the podcast?
Well, I did, you know, on the stage show, I recommended Don Lee. I think you should try to get him on the podcast.
Oh, yeah.
He's awesome. His first book, Yellow, right? The debut collection. I read it 2 years ago, so I was very late to the party, but great book. And his new one, Partition. And I think in 20 years, it's interesting and also fascinating to see the span of a person's career, you know, and I'm starting out, but he's kind of at both ends, right? So you can really see how he's changed. And he really is fascinating. He did an event with Jennifer Egan where he was like, you know, I used to not want to write Asian characters. And now these issues do preoccupy me and I have to write them. And I think that's important for, you know, next generation of people to think about is like, if you don't write Asian characters,
who's
going to write them? Right. Right. So that is something that I think was a really important message.
Yeah. Mm. 20 years ago, 30 years ago, maybe
it was harder.
Just didn't want to be known as an Asian author. Maybe
I know. And I think now it's, you know, you still see restrictions, right? Like red and yellow covers. Like there's still so many restrictions. And you know, people not understanding Asian characters. But I think one of the big things about representation is not just representation, but like engagement. You sort of need to have people like you guys who are really engaged with the work. And that's what kind of helps a lot, right? I think 20 years ago when Don Lee was writing, the Asians weren't reading.
No.
Yeah.
You know? And now Asians are reading, and that's important.
Yeah, no, there's a steady stream of authors coming out that, you know, I notice. I'm like, oh, should we try to get them on, you know?
Yeah.
So that's great. You know, it'll be a great problem to have if I have too many to choose from, right?
I know. But that's more books for you to read.
Right? I know. Yeah, no, that's good. That's good.
And you might not have time. Well, the APs are over, right? AP.
Yeah. No, I got summer. Yeah, I have summertime.
You got summertime.
Oh, man. So, Weike, thanks so much for coming along. It's been so fun talking to you.
Yeah, thank you so much. It was great.
Thank you, Emily. Of course.
Well, that does it for this episode. Best of luck in your career and on your books.
Thank you.
We're looking forward to it. You got more. You said you're working on something. You don't have to give away the farm here, but you're working on stuff.
Yeah, I just finished ish a novella. I think I need to do some editing for it in the next couple of days and just see if send it out to my agent, see how it goes. But yeah, doing a lot of, you know, I'm still writing. It's just I think every work that I want to do is I'm trying to do something a little different than what I did before,
right.
Mm-hmm. Just so it's not the same. And I'm sort of trying to do new techniques or new ideas or so it's been a fun process.
All right. So everyone out there, get a copy of Chemistry or Joan is Okay from your favorite local bookstore. You can follow Weike on Instagram at Weike Wang, and I'll put that in our show notes. And thank you too, Emily, for coming along and co-hosting today.
Yeah, thank you. This was awesome. This is like my first time in a podcast, so.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, you did great. And everyone out there, thank you so much for listening. We hope you learned something. That's one of our goals. And as mentioned, you can always write to us at infatuationpodcast@gmail.com. And give us a follow on Instagram or Facebook at The Infatuation Podcast. And we'll put all these details in the show notes. On behalf of Weike, Emily, and myself, we hope you're all happy, healthy, and safe out there. Talk to you again soon. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.